Okay, I think we're live. Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty, and I think it's ArtCast 340, and today I'm doing something a little different. I got a special guest come on the show, like awesome fantasy artist Jeff Mirancola. How you doing, Jeff?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on the show, Jeff. I appreciate it. Episode 340, that's insane. That's a lot of episodes, man.
Yeah. I've been doing it for a while.
Yeah.
And it's funny. It's actually, I think I got like 500 videos on my channel, like total, yeah. But that's just the art.
I know you do. I've looked at them. I'm like, I can't watch all of these, Jeff. Stop.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, I don't know. I've been wanting to get you on the show like for like quite a while. Cause honestly, you're my favorite artist on YouTube.
Oh,
maybe you and James Gurney, but you both of you guys do like such awesome videos that, you know, it just totally inspire the heck out of me.
That's cool.
I don't remember when you showed up. I mean, I've been doing videos for like quite a while, but it was like pretty early on when I found a few of yours, and, yeah. They're just so cool.
Yeah. Kind of did them as a goof at first, you know. I think I was just bored, and I'm like, well, this should be interesting and fun to do, and then it just kind of blew up and took off. And I didn't expect it to blow up the way it did, so that's cool.
That's really neat.
Yeah.
You know, before we even get started though, because like I always like to, you know, somebody's got a Kickstarter going, I want them to like stay it early, because I know people drop off over the interview, and I don't want to have to wait till the very end. But, Let's talk about your Kickstarter real quick before we even like talk about anything else. I mean, you're doing a painting DVD, like how to paint kind of thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, I mean, I'll just introduce myself first for all your viewers that might not know who I am. Sure. I started as a professional fantasy artist in 1993. So really dating myself there. I've been doing this for a long time, working on, for companies and projects like Magic the Gathering, Dungeons and Dragons, World of Warcraft. I've done stuff on Star Wars, TCGs, Mars Attack TCG. I've done pretty much every card game you can imagine in the 1990s, that when there was a huge card game craze going on. And I've done stuff for Shadowrun. I can't even think of them all right now. I've done so many things, so many different RPGs and book covers and you name it. I also do a lot of children's books and stuff like that too. I've been doing this stuff for a pretty long time, but I think I'm probably most known for my work on Magic the Gathering, because I've done quite a number of, I've been painting for that game since 1995. So
yeah,
I've been going strong with that. And so now I'm kind of at that point in my career where I'm, starting to give back a little bit more, you know, where I'm starting to, you know, I mean, there's this huge surge of like digital art, right? I mean, and certainly in the late 90s and in the early 2000s, all the digital art kind of came onto the scene, and everybody moved, a lot of people migrated over to creating digital art. And now there's this desire for people to kind of get back to traditional art a little bit as well. So that's what I'm doing, just like you are, and we're sharing our traditional art techniques, our drawing techniques, and you know, all that kind of stuff. And so that's that's what I'm doing with this Kickstarter. So this Kickstarter is for an oil painting techniques DVD or digital download. Last year I put out, earlier this year, I put out a DVD for acrylic painting techniques, and that's this thing right here. You probably have seen this already or know about this. It's like 6.5 hours worth of content on there. Like, it walks through the entire process of me creating a painting from beginning to end, and plus a whole lot of other extra stuff, like a studio walkthrough, Q&A, how to build your portfolio, tips on figure drawing, color mixing exercises. Yeah, there's so much stuff on there. And so I'm doing the same thing with the oil painting Kickstarter. Sorry, Jeff. Yeah. That was a long lead in to the I'm working on the oil painting techniques Kickstarter now. So
no, that's great.
I felt like I got to give some background to people that don't know who I am.
Well,
I like to think that everybody knows who Jeff Mirancola is, but they don't.
Yeah. The only thing is, like on my channel, I think it like people have been waiting honestly for me to get you on here like at some point because I like so many times in the comments people actually like talk about you on my channel and stuff.
That's cool, man. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, there's a ton of people.
Those people will be happy then.
Right. So yeah.
So now the oil painting one is like, I mean, you know, I've got all my videos on my YouTube channel and just like you do, Jeff, you know, there's only so much you can do with a video on your YouTube channel. It's not like you can put up a 6.5 hour long video on your channel. I mean, so they're always their little nuggets, you know, they're little 15 minute, half hour things, maybe an hour long, if that. The DVDs or the digital downloads, these extensive projects like the Kickstarter I'm doing right now, that's where I put all my effort into like making it the most comprehensive thing I can possibly do because I want it to be this resource that an artist or an educator or a librarian, anything like that, teacher can go back to again and again and again to kind of get more, you know, get information, inspiration, whatever, and just learn how to use these materials.
Yeah.
So
yeah. I agree. Like, you know, on a YouTube channel, you know, like stuff gets buried, you know, you tell people a lot of stuff, but then, you know, it just gets pushed down in the feed and, like right. Putting it all together in like one, you know, kind of course or something it's a good way. You know, I mean, I've had things like that on my channel where people, you know, you talk about something and then, like the next video, they just ask you like all the same questions you answered in the last one.
Right. Like, hey, I just answered that in the previous video.
Exactly.
But they don't always see every video that you make. And the thing about YouTube is that you always have new people coming on board. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, you know, for those people that have been subscribed to you for a long time, some of your videos can feel repetitive, but for a new person coming on board, they're seeing it for the first time. Mm-hmm. They don't know you've got 339 other episodes, yeah. Right? They've seen number 340. And so, yeah. So a lot of stuff you got to kind of repeat over and over and, it can get a little bit like Groundhog Day, you know, when you're making the videos.
That's a good way of putting it.
Yeah. So, but the bigger projects like the oil painting one, that's, I mean, I live for stuff like that. I'm glad I'm starting to do those because that's where I can just really get down and dirty in the details and all the stuff that people want to see, you know, move away from time lapse and do all real time stuff and really educate people and give them lots of information. An oil painting is way, way more complex than acrylic painting. I mean, there's so many different materials and things that are involved. And so, yeah, it's a good place to do it.
How did you, I mean, like your technique of painting, I always find it really interesting just from watching your channel and stuff. I mean, what's that built on? I mean, where did you kind of come to, like, you know, the Jeff Marincola way of painting?
Basically copying other artists really until I kind of maybe, you know, it's like everything, right? You steal a little bit from this person, a little bit from that person and from your influences. And that's really what I did. I think I could probably credit Frank Frazetta for my being my biggest inspiration when I was younger as an artist. And certainly I did a lot of paintings where I really aped his style and stuff like this. I probably have to say though that I credit Boris Vallejo with being my best teacher. You know, like I didn't actually meet him and he didn't teach me, you know, one on one. But he had an art techniques book that he put out many years ago.
Yeah,
where he broke down his painting process, and that resonated with me. And that I was like, okay, that's how you do it. That's how you're supposed to do this stuff. And I kind of took that and then a little bit of what I thought, how I thought Frazetta was building his paintings. And then then I took a little sprinkling of Brahm, you know, yeah. And a little sprinkling of Glenn Fabry and Simon Bisley, you know, just kind of put all those influences together and it was like, boom, Jeff Marincola, you know? And
right. Now somebody else is like doing all that, but they're sprinkling a little Marincola on top.
Yeah, right.
That's how it works, I think.
It is. It's how it works. We just pass it on, right, man?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You brought up Boris, and like I watch you paint, you know, and I find it really like interesting. You know, like Boris is very heavily photo referenced, you know what I mean? But I watch you paint, and a lot of times, you know, like there's stuff I can see where, you know, you're using like a model and stuff. And then there's stuff where I can just tell you're like going straight out of your head.
Yeah.
But your whole style kind of like ties together still. You know, I do that kind of stuff, but my style completely changes when I just draw out of my head.
This probably comes from when I was younger, like never using photo reference at all. Mm-hmm. I think just like all through my formative years, from my grade school, high school, and college years, I just don't think that photo reference like played into my process at all. A lot of the stuff just came out of imagination. I got really used to just observing things and mm-hmm. trying to draw them, and that became my method. And so I actually, to this very day, I mean, I struggle to use photo reference. I mean,
oh, really?
I use it. I'll use it occasionally. And I'll certainly, you know, if I've got to draw a creature or something like this and I can't quite get the hand position right, I'll say, hey, Sylvia, come over here and hold your hand like this so I can draw that real quick. And then I just use it for positioning, you know, and then I'll modify the hand so it looks like a creature's hand and not my wife's hand. But I really struggle using photo reference because it tends to lock me in. I want to copy the photo almost exactly, and so I don't start exaggerating things. I don't start like, you know, adding expression and all that kind of stuff and stretching the figure or whatever, doing things like that make it kind of more interesting. And so I don't know. I tend to try to stay away from photo reference, but and use it just as like for positioning and maybe lighting.
Yeah.
But I don't know that I've ever, with the exception of a couple paintings where I had to paint like a specific person or something like that, that's when I'd use the photo reference. And
yeah, that's interesting. I guess I thought you maybe used a bit more than you do then. And I agree with you. You know, like photo reference is definitely like a box, you know, it's like every time you get it out, you get in that box. And then when you put it away, you know, you're outside of that. And I don't know, when I was younger, I was definitely, you know, Frazetta nuts, you know, too, when I started. And I remember, you know, like this interview, and I bet you know it too, where he was like talking about, you know, I think like the quote was something like, you know, using photo reference, that separates the men from the boys. You know, he's talking about not using it, you know?
Right, right.
And
although we know now that he actually used a lot more photo reference than he claimed to have used.
Yeah. Yeah, once the internet started, you get to see like, you know, a lot of his swipes and stuff. But
right, right. But still, I mean, but it's clear though that from his technique and the way he drew and the way he approached things, that he very easily drew figures without photo reference.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think it was on both sides. I think I kind of like what you're saying, you know?
Right. Like I said, I think for me, the key was in my early years. I did probably two things that when I look back on it in hindsight, I think it really paid dividends for me. And that was, one thing that I did was, when I was in high school, one of my art teachers, did something where every year he went to our local public museum, mm-hmm. and there was a children's theater at that public museum. And we would sit out, me, the art teacher, and maybe another art student or two, we'd sit outside at a table outside this children's theater. And when all the kids came out of the theater, we would just sit there and draw for the children, whatever they wanted. Like, so the kids would come up to us and say, I want a unicorn driving a Ferrari. Can you draw that? Oh, okay. And so it's like we did that every year in high school, multiple times a year. And so it became this training ground for me where, you know, you had to think on your feet. You had to draw what you just, there was no photo reference around. There was nothing to base it on. And you just drew from your head. So that, I think, really helped me a lot. And then I also made it a point to copy all the drawings in some of my anatomy books. And I talked briefly about that in one of my videos on my channel about figure drawing, where I took one of the books by George Bridgman. I actually have it here because I knew I was going to talk about this, but that's the book.
Okay.
I can pull that up. So this book, when I was in high school and college, I literally redrew every single page of this book in my sketchbooks. And this was like this is an anatomy book that's not like, you know, oh, here's all the veins and all the bones and all. This is more just muscular and movement and kind of basic shapes and shadow and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Copying every single page of this book. And I have still have the sketchbooks with all my drawings in it of this. And it's like, it was the, that paid dividends, man. That was, yeah, that was the thing to do.
Yeah.
And I did it at the right time, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, all that stuff that comes along in those formative years, you know, it's like, I don't know if it's like luck or what, but I find that to be, you know, it really shapes you. You know what I mean? You look back and you go, God, if that didn't happen, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Hopeless, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, totally. That's I might not even be here if it weren't for like a friend of mine when I was 15 years old. He came to school and had the Frank Frazetta book one. You know, the thin Valentine books that they published in the 70s. And, you know, he came to school with that book and my mind was blown looking at every page, you know, in the hallway. And he just gave it to me. He's like, oh, you seem to love this so much. You can have it. I was like, that totally, I think that put me on this path, man.
Totally.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. You know, you were talking about that, you know, other art teacher and stuff. I mean, did you have anybody, you know, cause a lot of people, I think, you know, just learn everything by themselves and they have no help. And I was just wondering, like, did you have anybody like physical person, you know, that you knew that kind of like helped you in the beginning or was it not there?
No, not there. I mean, now when you say help, you talk about,
I guess, art techniques,
art techniques and stuff like that. No. Okay. No, not really. I mean, I credit my mom with getting me into a specialty high school, which is in here in Milwaukee. I went to a place called Milwaukee High School of the Arts, which it's a high school, but it specializes in the arts. So you're either in dance, music, theater, or visual art, and you spend at least 2 hours a day doing that. As well as all your other normal studies. It's not like a normal high school. There aren't any sports. There's no football team. There's none of that kind of stuff. It's just, it's like that movie Fame, you know, or that TV show Fame.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what it's like. You actually bet when I went, you actually had to audition to get into the high school.
Oh, wow.
So my mom got me in there. And so that was awesome. And, but I was kind of like, I don't know. When I was in high school, I did well. I did all right, like in my art and stuff like that, but I was a little distracted. I was kind of a troublemaker or class clown. I didn't study as hard as much as I should have, you know?
Yeah. And
so I don't think the art teachers really connected with me there because I didn't connect with them.
Yeah.
So no, I never really had anybody in those years to kind of guide me. I had a few teachers along the way that were encouraging and that really mattered a lot. But most of it is just self-taught, man. Most of it's just, you know, probably doing what you do. You know, you grab those books, you look through them, and you try to dissect how they were made. And
yeah,
that's what I do.
Yeah, absolutely. When did you kind of start, you know, like when did it go from like, you know, like when you're painting and all that kind of stuff? I mean, when did you start thinking about like a career and going in that direction? How'd you do that?
I feel like I always, like ever since I got into the high school of the arts, like I feel like, I mean, I always used to tell people, I'm going to be an artist. It just seemed to be something that was always in my head, even before I even knew what the heck that meant. I didn't know what that meant. I'm going to be an artist. And, you know, at that point, you're not thinking about, I'm going to be a business person and I've got to, you know, figure out contracts and how to invoice and all that stuff. But it got serious for me when I left college. I went to a four-year college in Milwaukee, the Milwaukee Institute of Art and Design, and only went 2 years because I couldn't afford to go anymore, so I had to drop out. And when I dropped out, and it was that year, that second year that I was in college, I had one of my teachers in school who was a very discouraging teacher. Basically told me, he said, you're never going to be able to freelance, Jeff. You're just going to go get a day job and you won't be able to do your art for maybe 10, 20 years. And so I kind of had this thing in my head, like, I'm going to prove this dude wrong. I'm going to prove him wrong, you know? And so it took me 2 years.
Nice.
Yeah. It took me 2 years after I left college. I spent that time just working a third shift job, working two jobs actually. And then in my free time, I was just working on paintings or drawings to build up my portfolio. And in 1993, I went to a convention, showed my stuff around, and got work from everybody that I showed it to. So, and then that was the beginning.
So, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's kind of, you know, like when I first started getting work, it was the same deal. Went to a con and showed your portfolio. I think those days are kind of gone though, a little bit.
Yeah, they're a little bit harder. It's not so back when I was doing it, it was, you know, you could go up to any booth and pretty much the person you needed to speak to was there. They had the art director or the editor at the show. And now that's a lot more rare. They don't bring the art directors out to every show, and then when they do, now they've got the whole, like, you know, portfolio sign-ups where you've got to basically get in line or get a slot to meet with them. And if you don't get that time slot, then you just don't, it just doesn't happen. That's because there's a lot more people that want to get into this industry now, man. So.
Yeah, that's true. Was that actually the beginning? I mean, did you just go like right into freelancing like a couple of years and then just stay in that the whole time? Or did you ever have to get like a second job or anything?
Oh yeah. Once my wife and I decided to have kids. Oh, kids.
Yeah.
Once we decided to have children, it was like, oh, kind of need that steady paycheck now, you know, before that it's like, okay, if they don't pay me in 30 days, they pay me in 90 days. Well, all right. That sucks, but that's life. I have to deal with it. But once you have children, once you have, you know, insurance to pay and your bills get a little bit bigger because now you had to buy a minivan, you know, things like this. Yeah. You know, the day job has to come. So at the reality sets in and, oh, day job.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did do freelance for many years. Until we decided to have children, you know, not many years. Well, it was like we had kids in 97. So like 4 years, I did freelance for 4 years. 4 or 5 or 6 years, and then my second daughter came along is when we were like, okay, two kids, kind of expensive.
That's twice as bad.
I was okay with the first. With my first daughter, I remember her sitting, I'm having her here, and I'm painting here, you know, like, and she'd be sitting there working on, you know, something while I'm painting. But once the second one came along, I was like, okay, we got to change things.
That's cool.
Yeah. And so, yeah, then I got the day job, and the day job was in design. So I had to still do something creative, you know?
Right.
So I went and got a job at a design firm and then kind of worked my way all the way up to creative director over the years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. And then decided enough was enough. My next step was becoming a full blown suit, you know, and I'm like, I'm not the executive wing type. So,
right.
I don't get along with those executives too well. So
that's so cool.
Going back to freelance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How, you know, cause like you went through like the thing, cause I, you know, went through it too, where like, you know, but you know, you start your career and there's like no internet, you know, the whole business is completely different. And then like the internet comes and then everything changes and it's like a whole different world.
Yeah.
I mean, how did that like affect your whole career and stuff?
You know, I think, I think it's actually been good for sure.
Yeah.
I'm able to, you know, I think we look back on, you know, the early 90s and as like this period where, oh man, things just seem so much easier or less stressful and didn't have distractions. And that's true. But, you know, I remember, you know, whenever I finished assignments for publishers, paintings, things like this, you know, we had to mail them off to the publisher and they would handle photographing them, scanning them or whatever. And we'd get the painting back. Maybe, you know, like, I'm not kidding you, Jeff. There's one publisher, I won't name them because they're still around. I'm still cool with some of the people there, but they sent some of my work back completely folded in half.
Oh my God.
Like they took paintings, they took drawings and they went like, we got to put them into this padded envelope. So let's fold them and put them into the envelope And that's how I got paintings back. You know, thankfully that doesn't happen anymore because of the internet, because now, you know, we're basically in charge of scanning or photographing our own work and manipulating it in, you know, digitally if we have to, and then getting that file to the publisher. So, so that's nice.
Yeah.
Really a difficult transition for me, really. It wasn't, because I think because I got the day job in the design world, I kind of like, you know, adopted computers pretty early, and I kind of, I got into learning programming languages. I got into just accepting the internet and accepting the way of doing things online, for my day job. So I don't think it affected me that much.
Yeah. Well, I think, yeah, I'm definitely with you there. I mean, I personally, I think it's a lot better, you know, like I could never really make a living consistently until the internet came along. You know? It was just so much harder to find clients back then.
Because, you know, your only option was to, you know, advertise in those gigantic 3-inch thick source books, you know, where they wanted to charge you $5,000 for a page, you know, to advertise in these books. And they really had a lock on that, man, you know, and there was really no other way to reach clients. Like you said, you'd have to do postcard mailings and stuff like that. And nowadays it's like, you know, it's a lot more organic, and they can find you through social media or through your website, and or you just send somebody a link. It's just so much nicer, you know.
Right.
And you can have, like, I suppose you could do this without the internet, doesn't really, but I've got like multiple like genres that I'm in. I'm in the fantasy art world with all my paintings, but then I'm in the children's book world with the digital children's book stuff that I do. Yeah. And I think that was that's a direct result of the internet, you know?
That's cool.
Yeah.
How did since you brought that up, I remember like your last Kickstarter was with your wife, and you guys were doing was it like a children's book? It was an illustrated book, right?
So if you're talking about a book that was, my wife writes novels.
I see. It was an illustrated novel.
She writes young adult novels. And so that's what it was for. And I designed the cover for the novel, and for that particular Kickstarter that we ran for hers, I did a series of like limited edition exclusive prints of the artwork featuring characters from her book. But that artwork wasn't printed in the actual book. Oh. It was just like the set of prints that I kind of did as a nice little incentive for people to back the project.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah,
I didn't realize that those weren't in there. So like you do also children's books? I didn't even know about that actually.
Yeah, no, a lot of people don't, because I kind of like, I'm keeping a secret. No, it's just, I think I got to a point where sometime in the early 2000s where I was maybe losing a little bit of inspiration and a little motivation to do paintings and stuff like this. I wanted to kind of take a break and try something new. I'm the kind of artist that I'm like that, you know, man. I have a hard time sticking to one thing. That's why it's like I do acrylic paintings, oil paintings, ink drawings. I do digital art. I'm kind of all over the place, like with my materials. And so I felt like I wanted to try something new and different, and I wanted to do stuff digitally in the computer, but I didn't want it to be a digital version of my fantasy art style. You know, you see this a lot with artists that are work traditionally in fantasy, and then they move over and they do stuff in Painter or in Photoshop, and it's amazing how it looks just like their painted stuff, their traditionally painted stuff. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do something completely different. And so my children's book stuff is like a totally different style than my fantasy art. You wouldn't even know it was me if you saw the two of them side by side. And why I did that, kind of for fun, mostly because I got contacted by a publisher to do a book, and I used that opportunity to try this new look, this new style, and then that led into, once I did that one book, another publisher saw that, and another publisher saw that, and another publisher, you know, it kind of like grew. I never actually had to even search out any work in the children's field. It was really funny. They just, you do one project and the other publishers see it.
Yeah.
And then they reached out to me. So I haven't done a whole lot. I haven't done a lot, but I've done like activity books for Klutz. You know, I don't know if you've seen those at the store where They're like books that usually come with something like a physical thing of some sort, you know, like that. So I've done klutz activity books. I've done picture books. Yeah, been fun.
Like some markers or stickers or something. And
yep, exactly.
Package, yeah.
Yep.
That's neat. I mean, that's interesting. Like that first publisher that wanted you to do that stuff. And you know, did they approach you because of your fantasy art, or was it just?
They did. They approached me because of my fantasy art, and I kind of proposed this new look to them, and they were on board with it. So yeah. And that publisher had seen something. This is how it goes sometimes, man. That publisher approached me because I did work on an iPod or iPhone game for Electronic Arts. I did like this mini golf game where I did all the graphics for the game, video game. And the publisher saw that and thought that look would be good for this children's book. So they approached me. And so I was like, but I'd like to do this digitally this way. And they were like, great, let's do it. And so I did it. And it's just kind of like, it was kind of interesting. It's nice because the fantasy art world is somewhat finite, you know what I mean? There's an awful lot of artists trying to get in and get work from just a handful of companies, and there's only so much artwork that they can contract out for.
Yeah.
So I think now more than ever, you got to be diverse as an illustrator. You know, I mean, you don't have to be. There's an awful lot of artists, Jeff, that they just have their one style. They stick with their whole life, and that's that, and that's their brand, their stamp, and that is what it is. But for me, I felt like if I needed to open up and add some new clients, I needed to kind of step outside that fantasy world, step outside the comfort zone and do something a little different. And yeah, it worked out.
Okay. That's awesome. You know, I was just looking at that painting behind you, you know, that awesome Mars Attacks thing. And I got a technique type question, or maybe it's a materials one, but sure. Like there's kind of that sheen on it. Do you varnish your pieces?
Yep.
Okay.
I do. I mean, I'll let it, it all depends on how thickly I paint it.
Yeah.
I mean, most of my oil paintings are actually pretty thinly painted. Most of my oil paintings are not built. I'm not sitting there gobbing on the paint, you know. If I were to do that, then I wouldn't be able to varnish my painting for like a year.
Yeah.
So most of my stuff is pretty thin. So I'm able to varnish it, you know, a few weeks to a month after completing the painting.
Okay.
And so that's what I do. But I still varnish it with a retouch varnish. I don't use a permanent varnish on it. I use a varnish that's got, you know, can breathe more. Yeah.
That's interesting. I varnish my acrylics, but it's like all of my oil paintings I never do. I remember when I was younger, you know, I had a friend who painted in oil and he kept varnishing his pieces and you know, I guess they just weren't 100% dry, and you know, they got all murky and oxidized or whatever, and it was just a big mess. So I've always been kind of scared of varnishing an oil painting. But.
Yeah, that'll happen. I learned that the hard way with one of my first oil paintings. I remember I did this oil painting, and I had to turn it in for the, matter of fact, this this was actually the first oil painting that I ever did for Wizards of the Coast. And it wasn't for Magic the Gathering. It was for another game.
Yeah.
And they gave me this assignment. They were like, Jeff, like your art. I need you to do this painting for this thing. I was like, great, this is awesome. And so I painted it in oils, and I had it with me in my car. And I live in Wisconsin, so it's really cold here. And this was like during the cold winter months. I had the painting in the car, and I went to work and left it in my car. And after work, I'm like, okay, I got to varnish this thing before I send it off to them. I don't know why I felt like I needed to do that, but you know, because that, you know, varnishing the painting, like it you know, it evens out all the color. It kind of brings back your, you know, the nice rich blacks and things like that. So I was like, I got to varnish this so it looks its best, you know? And so I varnished my painting when I just pulled it out of the car.
Oh no.
Right? I mean, it was incredible. Don't ever try this, but I mean, unless you want to like experiment with this and for fun. So I took the painting indoors and I varnished it, and immediately the entire painting turned white.
Yeah.
Like the whole thing just like frosted over, like it just turned white. I was like, oh my God, I just ruined my painting. I got to turn this in. It's like my first assignment with Wizards of the Coast. So I'm taking the painting and I'm running this thing under hot water to just get all the bugs. I just put on it. It was was terrible. I managed to save the painting.
Really? It actually took it off, huh?
Yeah, I managed to get all that stuff off and save the painting, and it was fine.
That's pretty awesome.
That is lesson learned about varnish, wait. Take your time. Like, the painting's got to be at the right temperature, and, you know, you got to give time for the oil paints to actually thoroughly dry. Not dry to the touch, but actually dry under the surface.
Yeah.
Yeah. So otherwise that stuff will happen. I'll cover all that stuff in my oil painting DVD when I do it. So I'll see if I can recreate that mistake I made. That would be pretty cool.
Well, it's wild that you actually got it off. I remember one time I did an oil painting. I left it outside and I was just letting it dry, you know, because I'm always kind of fighting with it, trying to get stuff dry. And me and Tanya went somewhere, you know, some road trip. And it rained like hell on it for like 2 days. You know? And I came back and I'm like, that thing has got to be just dead, you know. And it was fine. It took all that water and it looked fine still. I couldn't believe it.
Maybe not in 100 years, though. In 100 years, it'll just be all cracked and shriveled up. Who knows? But we'll be dead by then. It's not our problem.
That's right. That's right. I guess, what about, may as well talk about a little about YouTube.
Sure.
You came onto YouTube and like took it over, became like the king of YouTube.
Did I? I don't know.
No, but I mean, you know, you came on YouTube and you definitely, I don't know what, like where your audience was and everything like that, but you know, you definitely kind of blew up or whatever.
It's interesting.
A strong audience over there.
I think there's this, you know, you probably see it too. I mean, you know, I've taken the time to peruse YouTube I didn't at the time when I uploaded my first couple of videos, I was just, I was making them for myself. And I thought some of the fans that I did have might find it interesting. But I figured most of my fans, they're fans of my art and they're fans of the products that my art appears on, but they're not necessarily artists and they're not necessarily fans of my art, the way I create my art.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so I just thought, well, I'll just put this up there for fun and see if it, you know, does well. And yeah, then all of a sudden it kind of took up, like you said, and people were interested. And so once I did that, I started to look around YouTube and see, well, what else is out there? And, you know, you see in the comments of what people complain about with other videos and what they hope to see out of other videos and things like this. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I can probably create videos that are not like these, you know, and it's kind of a typical thing. If an artist doesn't have a background in video production or a design sense, they're not necessarily thinking about, you know, they oftentimes just set up one camera and from far away, and they are working on their canvas over here, and you can't quite really see what they're doing. It's like it's neat entertainment-wise. It's neat to see the thing come to life, but you don't actually learn anything from watching it.
Mm-hmm.
So my thing was that I wanted to make sure that my videos had close-ups, that it had real-time video, and that I did voiceover so that I explain what I'm doing or the materials I'm using so that when people watched it, they could watch it for entertainment purposes. Sure. I think most of my YouTube subscribers use it for that purpose. But then you've got that segment that is like, oh, I actually learned something. Okay. This is cool. Okay. That's a, you know, neat tool. And I see the way he's holding it and how he's using it. So.
Yeah. Now that makes sense, you know, because your videos are like really informative. I've definitely learned some stuff from them too.
Yeah.
I mean, do you, is that kind of what led into like doing like the DVD kind of courses? I mean, cause you're already doing videos, or was that sort of something you wanted to do like long before?
Yeah, it's exactly what led into it. Because you probably know, man, you got a pretty extensive YouTube library and channel too. I mean, it's when you put the stuff out there, you're going to get a huge segment of people that are like, okay, that's awesome. More, 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 give me more. Yeah. And you're like, whoa, dude, this stuff takes a while to produce. Hold on, you know? and so you're always, at least I am always struggling with because my videos are a lot more involved, you know, with different camera angles, a lot, you know, more extensive editing and the voiceover and things like this, that I can't put out a video every week like I'd like to. So it just, the people were, I put out an acrylic one, I put out an oil one, and then people were like, more, more, more. And I'm like, oh, okay, if I'm going to spend the time to do like a real extensive thing, I want it to be something that I can package into a DVD or into a digital download file that really does answer all the questions that I can anticipate people having about the medium, you know, and about the process. And also the other flip side to that, Jeff, was that I started to think more and more about, you know, giving back and especially to younger people. And so I started thinking, well, I'd love for this to be in libraries. I would love for this to be available in schools. And schools and libraries are still pretty heavily on DVDs. You know, they're not going to be moving to high def digital downloads anytime soon.
Right.
So that's why I did the Kickstarter to help produce physical DVDs so that, you know, because there are still people in the world that use DVD players, but mostly it's about institutions and stuff like that, that I want them to have this.
No, that makes sense. Yeah. I mean, you know, because not everybody's on the internet, even though it seems like, you know, like my whole life revolves around the internet and everything. But, you know, there's still people like, you know, like my dad and stuff that just, they don't care about the internet. They're still like,
yep,
you know, and it's like, if they can't get it on DVD, they're not going to watch it or whatever. But exactly. The thing about the schools is really, really cool. And that's just something I never even thought about, you know?
Oh, yeah. I think because what you'll find here's the one of the things that brought made me think about schools was that I started hearing from teachers and from students that said that they were playing my videos in their classrooms.
Oh, wow.
My YouTube videos. And so I'm getting these emails from students going, you know, Jeff, you're awesome. You know, found out about you from my teacher because, you know, he was playing or she was playing the videos in class today and in art class. And I was like, what? You know, yeah. Where's my royalties?
Yeah.
No, I didn't say that. I was like, that's really awesome. Like, and it's one of those things you don't necessarily think about because you're cooped up in your studio, you're creating your video and you just put it out there in the world. You don't think about maybe all the places that it ends up being viewed. And I certainly didn't foresee teachers showing my videos in their classroom.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, that's pretty awesome. So that was one of the other things when I put together the acrylic DVD was like, okay, I'm going to make this so that, you know, teachers can also, you know, actually show it in their classroom if they want. I'm going to contain myself and I'm not going to swear, you know, and I'm like, I'll make it friendly, you know, that kind of stuff. So yeah, it was pretty neat, man.
Yeah. Everything, you know, I'm just always amazed by that. But everything, you know, like you think you get to a certain point, and you're like, oh, it's starting to blow up or whatever. But like, it seems like, you know, as things go on, everything just continues to like grow, you know, or die or whatever. But it's like, it blows me away, like how much, like big, you know what I mean? It's just like wherever you think something is like right now, yep. You know, like in 4 or 5 years ago, it's like in a place that you just never thought of,
yep.
And it just kind of. It's crazy like that with like a YouTube video where, you know, YouTube was just like this fool around thing and just where people put like just goofy whatever. Right. And then like, you know, now here it is a few years later, it's like, you know, a teacher finds it. He's like just playing it in school. It's like an actual resource for them. And it's just, you know, like in another 5 years, it's going to be who knows where it's at. You know, it's just crazy how things grow like that.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, it's, I hear you, man. And who knows what's going to happen with it. That's a really neat thing about it though, with the YouTube is that it's got, you know, it's got a bigger reach than we could ever hope to have, you know, people aren't discovering, you know, jeffmaricola.com or, you know, jefflafferty.com necessarily. They're out there, you know, they're on YouTube and then they stumble across your stuff and it's like, oh wow. You know? And so that's pretty cool. That's really awesome, the reach that they have. That's the reason why this, like the DVDs too and stuff like that, they're on Amazon because for the same reason, like Amazon's got that reach, you know,
that I
don't have. So
yeah, exactly. You put it on your site, that's one thing, but you put it on Amazon, it's like putting it in Walmart or something.
Exactly. Right. It's out there, you know, making money while you sleep, basically. And
yeah,
that's pretty cool.
That's neat. Actually, like, as long as we're talking like Kickstarter, I ran a Kickstarter a while ago, and I'm just, you know, curious about like the production of it and everything. I mean, do you like go and get a big chunk of like DVDs made, and then there's like an end of a print run at some point, or is it kind of like almost like a print on demand type situation where they're continually made, or how does that all work?
No, it's not print on demand. It is like I get X number made, you know. So it's either like I get 1,000 or 2,000 or 3,000 or whatever it is that the Kickstarter pays for is then what I'll get made. And
so like, okay.
Yep.
And then so like with Amazon, is it, because I know people that do like Kickstarters and type of stuff, and then they'll send, you know, like 4 crates of books to Amazon, and they like store them in their warehouse, and they send them, like they fulfill. Are you sending each one? Do you have somebody else doing that for you, or is it like a situation where Amazon's sending it?
It's all me, man. It's all me. right now, I need some assistance for sure, but right now it's just all me. I need like little elves, you know, that can just help me with all this stuff. But no, it's Amazon has a couple different kinds of programs. There's like one called Fulfillment by Amazon. I think that's what you just mentioned, where it's like, yeah, you send them like stuff and then they will fulfill it. And I'm in a different program of theirs. It's called Amazon Advantage. And it's that program is specifically for publishers of books and DVDs and CDs, like music. So those three things is what that program is for. And so I set this whole thing up. Like, in other words, so my wife and I, we created a publishing company, an actual LLC to house all of the things that we create. So the DVDs, her books, or whatever books I've got coming out next year, stuff like that. So that's the hub for everything. And then I created, using that LLC, I got that agreement with Amazon Advantage, you know. So it's a little bit different. I still ship stuff to Amazon, but it's like on demand, meaning like 1 week they'll send me an order for 10 DVDs, and then I ship those 10 to them, and then the next week they'll send me one for 30 DVDs, and then I send the 30, you know, because when they've sold out, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, that's interesting. So it's almost like a little halfway point between that, like fulfill, or I can't remember what that's called, that Amazon Fulfillment or something, but
it's called Fulfillment by Amazon or something like that. I think that's what it's actually called. There's three different programs that they have, and I'm on the one that just makes sense for us as a publisher,
right?
Because we do publish DVDs and books and stuff like that. If you were gonna like sell other products, like if you were gonna say sell coffee mugs and all that would be something with one of their other programs.
Right.
Yep.
Right. No, that makes sense. I sell my prints on Amazon also, but it's almost like eBay, where you just, you know, it's listed on Amazon, and when it sells, like I fulfill it myself, you know?
Oh, that's cool.
So I guess that's like a third way to do it on Amazon.
Well, that's kind of cool though, because so then you can list it up there, like you said, like eBay, and then Amazon basically just communicates with you, sends you an email saying, hey, okay, you need to ship this to this person.
Exactly. And I ship it straight to the customer. So.
And then Amazon gets their massive cut.
Right. They take their pound of flesh.
Yeah.
That's cool though. Because I ship like stuff all the time. I think everybody should know how to ship if you're gonna be an artist, because it's a huge chunk of my business. It's interesting that you're doing it too. So,
well, that's the thing that goes back to what you were talking about earlier about the benefits of the internet. Now, I think that one of the greatest things about it is the ability to connect directly with a fan, which is something you didn't have before. You know, before you weren't able to do that.
Yeah.
You know, and now it's like, yes, somebody can reach out to me and say, Jeff, I want to buy this DVD or I want to buy this art print, and I can actually send it to them myself and I can communicate with them directly. It's just, it's a beautiful thing, man.
Yeah, it is. It's pretty awesome. Yeah. So like, you know, like we're talking all about, you know, this whole thing and like the DVDs and everything. And, you know, a lot of it to me is like you pushing on your knowledge, you know, like sending it on down the line, which is a really cool thing. Like what kind of advice, you know, would you give to like somebody like starting now? You know what I mean? Like we started a long time ago and everything was different, but like, man, you know, like I get that question a lot, and sometimes I find myself at a loss because it's so different now. It's just completely different.
Yeah, I'm with you there, man. We're a bunch of old men, Jeff. I've got three kids. They're all in, like, one's in college, two are in high school, and I'm like, I think to myself all the time, wow, I can't imagine being a kid nowadays, like with the stuff that they got to deal with, the stuff they have to do. So yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat with you. I'm like, boy, if I were an artist just coming onto the scene today, it would be awfully scary. I feel like I got quite lucky getting into the industry when I did, because I got in at a time where there wasn't this, there was competition, but it wasn't like it is now, and it wasn't global like it is now. And so I'd imagine people coming on board now wanting to work for these companies, it's got to be quite scary, because I think the level at which you need to enter the marketplace, skills-wise, is much higher than it used to be. The bar has been set a lot higher with stuff. That being said, there are always small companies, there are always small publishers, there are always people where you can kind of like sneak in the back door of the industry, where you can kind of get your feet wet and hit the ground, make it a little bit easier. Yep, it's going to be lower pay or no pay and stuff like this, but there's always still some opportunities out there, And the advice I'd probably give somebody, I mean, Jeff, I'm surprised, man. I've given advice to a lot of young artists, okay? In this day and age, I am surprised at how many of them do not have a website. And I still give that advice, and I feel like such an old man saying it. I'm like, you need a website. Like, I feel like I'm saying something so obvious, right? Well, it's like, duh, you need your digital business card out there. It needs to be out there. And these younger artists are like, oh, you're right, I should have a website. I'm like, what? Like, I'm actually informing you this? Like, that's not cool. Like, you should know this. Like, your schools should be telling you this. You should be coming to this conclusion on your own. Like, you need to have a website, right? And so I think the thing I harp on the most, and I know I'm talking a lot here, Jeff,
It's all right.
is it's never too early to learn the business end of being an illustrator. It's never too early to start thinking about your brand, start thinking about my business card, start thinking about my website, start thinking about the signature in my emails, and like how to write proper emails to people, and how to be professional, and how to dress, and how to talk with a client at a convention. It's never too early to start thinking about that, and understanding contracts, understanding invoices. You don't necessarily want to, the first time you've ever looked at a contract or ever looked at how to build an invoice, be when you got your first job and they asked you for an invoice and you're trying to scrambling, trying to figure out, oh my God, what's an invoice? So it's never too early to start that stuff and start thinking about taxes and about your deductions that you can possibly take. I know it's a lot, but I feel like it's not too early to start thinking about that stuff. And I tell that to all the young people. It's like, yes, and all that, and you still have to create amazing art, to get noticed, because the art is what's going to get you noticed. So, but then but it's like you could be the best artist ever, and then you have you're a terrible person to communicate with business-wise. You don't answer your emails right away. All that kind of stuff, and you can lose jobs, because of it. So, yeah.
Well, that is awesome. I guess that's it. I wanted to say, just like personally, though, that thanks for coming on the show again, and
Oh, pleasure,
you've been a
man.
big inspiration to me, actually. Just your videos and stuff. I didn't really know you much from like gaming art, because I just don't follow that world much. But I don't know. I like watching you paint, so keep
That's
making those
cool, man.
videos, man.
That's good. I like watching you draw, dude. I mean, I think I told you that I commented on one of your videos the other day. I don't get a chance to comment enough on stuff, but I do watch your videos, just so you know, because
Awesome.
I love that too. I love seeing people work. I love seeing people draw, and I like watching you draw, because I mean, you can't see because the camera's facing this way, but the other side of my room, I've got all my Drew Struzan posters. And so when I watch you draw, it just reminds me of Drew Struzan, and I'm just like, it's just one of those infectious styles. Like, it just makes you want to do it. Whenever it's like every time I got my Big Trouble in Little China poster over there, and every time I look at that thing, I'm like, oh, Jeff, just give up painting and just get back to the colored pencils and stuff. You know, it's just so awesome. And that's why I like watching you work. I like watching you do your stuff because it reminds me very much of Drew's drawing techniques and his approach and the textures that he achieves. So the textures that you're getting in your work and stuff like that, and that's pretty cool, man. Yeah, that's fun stuff.
Well, thanks. Struzan's like, you know, huge influence and one of my favorite artists, so that's pretty cool.
That's cool. Yeah. Thanks for coming on, man. I appreciate it.
No problem. I appreciate you coming on. Everybody should go and check out this guy's DVD, though, that Kickstarter thing. I'm definitely going to pick one up because I want to get some more secrets. But
you want to pick up some oil? Do you do oil painting?
I do. Yeah, sometimes. It's just on and off, though.
It's on and off, right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like, for some reason, I feel like you work more in acrylics than you do in oils.
I definitely work a ton more in acrylics. But, you know, if you go hunting back through my massive list of videos, you'll find a couple oils every now and then in there. But
do you enjoy it?
I actually do really like it, but the thing about it that with me is it's just the smells get to me at some point, and then I just get sick of it and I just put it all away.
Yeah, I think I killed all those brain cells like already. So I'm pretty used to it. So I mean, I use the odorless stuff, you know, the Gamsol odorless thing. So it doesn't really bother me much anymore. But
oh really?
Yeah. But I'm, you know, who knows. I've killed so many brain cells probably doing this.
Totally.
I probably shouldn't say that. I'm about to put out an oil painting DVD. I'm like,
yeah.
You're going to die young if you do this.
Well, you know, you work in acrylics and, you know, you do a lot of ink drawings and stuff. Are you painting like an oil like every day or is it kind of more?
No.
Yeah.
No, it's just, it all depends on the assignment. And like lately the assignments that I've had, I've slowed down with taking assignments from clients because I'm working a lot more on my own stuff, which is really nice. But when I do take the assignments from clients, like it just seems like more and more lately, the deadlines just keep getting shorter and shorter and shorter with clients. And they, you know, they want stuff in a week, they want stuff in 3-4 days. And so there's just doing an oil painting is sometimes not possible. So I leave oil paintings for those projects from clients that I've got, you know, 3 weeks on or for the personal paintings that I'm doing, that kind of stuff.
Really? Okay.
So that's why it's mostly acrylics for that.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. I draw on stuff every day and it's like, I think that's like the thing, like with the oils, like when I kind of start working in them again, it's just like, I can't see doing it like every day, you know, coming in and smelling it every morning, but
it's a whole it's a whole different mindset when you work with oils. Like it's, you know, unless you're a plein air painting like James Gurney, right? I mean, although even he's not working in oils when he does that stuff, but if you were to do plein air paintings in oils, well, you know, you'd have a finished painting at the end of your session. But the way in which I work with oils, with all the glazes and the building up of layers and all that kind of stuff, it's a whole different mindset, man. You got to have this patience about you and this vision to know what the painting is going to look like in 3 weeks, and that ability to kind of carry you through all that ungodly ugly stage of the painting for like 2 weeks, right? And be able to, you know, plow through that to get to the nice meaty fun stuff at the end. Because it's not like, you know, like you do, you sit down and draw. It's like, okay, you do a drawing and it's done in an hour. You're like, there you go. It's done in an hour and it's awesome. I rock. <You know? laughs> But, with oil painting, it takes a whole different mindset. It takes a different kind of person to have that kind of patience to see it through.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. It definitely, I don't know, like 3 weeks, but it's a long time, but you know, you get the results. So.
Yeah, exactly. In the end, you get this like awesomely rich, colorful, you know, just meaty painting that's just fun for people to look at
Awesome. Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to put the link, you know, I'm sure it's going to be down in the show notes, obviously, to the Kickstarter. And also, I'm going to stick it on the screen, like on the cards thing.
Awesome, dude.
So everybody go pick it up. Check it out.
I appreciate that.
It's okay. Thanks again for coming on the show.
Yeah, man.
All right. And I'll see everybody later.